This morning we continue our study from the book of Philippians. We'll be in Philippians 1, 18 through 26. In just a moment, I think Tyler might have looked ahead to what our sermon was going to be about based on what we sang, because we sang about a lot of things we're going to be talking about. To God be the glory, and all glory goes to God. We sang just a moment ago about how we'll praise God and bless Him when times are going well for us and when times are going badly for us, and in all of those circumstances we're praising Him. So we've seen Paul writing the book of Philippians. He's in prison in the city of Rome, and we're going to see this week that in particular he's waiting to go before the Roman emperor, before Caesar, for trial. And in Philippians chapter 1, verse 18, he turns to this upcoming trial before the Roman emperor. So let's look first at Philippians 1, verses 18 through 20. Paul says, "What does it matter? Just that in every way, whether out of false motives or true, Christ is proclaimed. And in this I rejoice, yes, and I will rejoice. Because I know this will lead to my deliverance through your prayers and help from the Spirit of Jesus Christ. My eager expectation and hope is that I will not be ashamed about anything, but that now as always, with all boldness, Christ will be highly honored in my body, whether by life or by death." Well, last week we left off with verse 18, and this week we pick up with verse 18, because verse 18 transitions from Paul looking at his present circumstances to Paul looking forward to rejoicing in his trial before the Roman emperor, before Caesar. If you remember last week, if you were here with us, Paul was talking about his own present circumstances. Paul reminded the Philippians that he was in prison. And not only was he in prison, but he had these opponents who were preaching the gospel with the goal or with the aim of causing Paul trouble. And in verse 18, we saw what was Paul's response. What was Paul's response to his imprisonment? What was Paul's response to these people who were causing trouble for him? And in verse 18, we see his response is what? I rejoice. Why? Because Jesus Christ is being proclaimed. Even if Paul was in prison, even if people were preaching the gospel with false motives, Paul simply rejoiced because the message of Jesus Christ was going forth. Verse 18 ends by Paul saying, "And not only that, but I will rejoice." Paul begins to look forward to the future now, beyond his present circumstances, forward to what awaits him in the very near future. So let's remind ourselves of why Paul was in prison in Rome. Paul wasn't arrested in Rome in this case. He was actually arrested in the city of Jerusalem. Paul had gone to the city of Jerusalem after his third missionary journey, taking a monetary gift for the Christians there in Jerusalem. And Paul went there, he went to the temple and did various different things, and basically some of the Jewish people in Jerusalem stirred up trouble against Paul and had him arrested. They brought false accusations against Paul, basically. They said he was defiling the temple and claiming that Paul did things, in fact, that he didn't really do. So they had Paul arrested. Paul was taken from Jerusalem to the city of Caesarea, and Paul was left in prison for 2 years in Caesarea. He was there under two different governors, and finally I think Paul gets the idea they're not going to do anything. They're just going to let him stay there in prison because it makes the Jewish opponents of Paul happy. And so Paul finally appeals to Caesar, to the Roman emperor. Paul was a Roman citizen, so this was his right. Any Roman citizen had the right to appeal to Caesar. We've talked before about it's sort of like how we have the right to appeal our case to the Supreme Court if it comes to that. Well, Paul appeals his case to the Roman emperor, and so he's taken to Rome and left in prison in Rome, awaiting the day when he would finally go before the emperor and plead his case or present his case to the emperor. So Paul waits probably about another 2 years or so in prison in Rome, and somewhere during this 2 years while he's in prison in Rome, he writes this letter to the Philippians. So now, in verses 19 through 20, Paul is looking forward now. He's looking forward to the fact that he's going to appear before the emperor, present his case to the emperor, and Paul's claim is that he's going to rejoice in this opportunity. Now, why would Paul rejoice? Look at verse 19. Paul says this. He says, "For Job. You know that Job was going through all different kinds of trials in the book of Job. If you read Job chapter 1, you find that Job was a righteous man, that he was doing what was right in God's eyes. In Job chapter 1, God himself says of Job that Job was a man of perfect integrity who feared God and turned away from evil. So Job was righteous, and not only that, Job was righteous, but he had also been blessed by God with a family, with wealth, with possessions, with all manner of different things. And so Satan basically came to God and said to God, listen, this guy Job only worships you because you've given him all this stuff. If you took all this stuff away from Job, then Job would stop worshiping. God is saying, no, that's not the case, but he allows Satan to test or to tempt Job. He allows Satan to take away Job's family, to take away Job's possessions, to take away, even in some senses, part of Job's health. But God says that you can't take his life. So Job is going through this period of intense trial. Something that probably, and none of us have been through a trial that severe where we've lost that much like Job did. All of his children dead. All of his possessions gone. And Job, in the midst of this, has these friends who are, maybe friend is a loose term to use for some of them, right? Because they're not acting very friendly toward Job. But basically, these friends come to Job and they basically make the claim to Job. They say, listen, Job, you must have done something wrong. For things to be going this bad for you, you have to have done something wrong. So what you need to do is to repent of whatever you've done wrong and turn back to God so that God will forgive you and things will go better for you. So in Job 13, Job is responding to a guy by the name of Zophar who has just made the claim to Job that Job needed to repent so that God would rescue him. And Job's claim is, no, I'm not suffering because of my sinfulness. I'm not suffering because I did anything wrong. It's not that Job was claiming to be perfect, but Job's claim was that his bad circumstances were not a punishment from God from some sin he had committed. So look at Job 13, beginning in verse 15. Job says, even if he kills me, I will hope in him. This is Job's claim about God. He says, listen, all of this stuff has been taken away from me. My children are gone. My possessions are gone. My wealth is gone. All of these things have been taken away from me. And Job says, even if God takes my life, I will hope in him. I will still defend my ways before him. Verse 16, Job goes on to say, yes, this will result in my deliverance. Does that sound very similar to what Paul says in Philippians chapter 1? Yes, this will result in my deliverance. And Job says, for no godless person can appear before him. Job goes on in verses 17 and 18. In verse 17, he says, pay close attention to my words. Let my declaration ring in your ears. Now then, I have prepared my case. I know that I am right. So in the book of Job, we have the case of a righteous sufferer. Someone who is suffering not because they have done something wrong, but they have done what is right, and yet they are still suffering anyway. Paul was in a very similar situation to Job, was he not? Some people get put in prison because they do things wrong, but Paul was not in prison because he did something wrong. Paul was basically in prison because he was preaching the gospel message, and people hated him. So Paul was in a very similar situation to Job. He was going through trials. He was going through difficulties and ordeals, not because God was punishing for some particular sin in his life, but he was suffering, in fact, even though he had done what was right. So we see a very similar attitude from Paul and from Job. Both of them basically say, listen, I'm going to be delivered from this trial even if it means that I die. They understood that their deliverance by God was not conditioned on their continuing in this earthly life. Job says, if God takes my life, still I will praise him. So God can take away his possessions or allow Satan to take away his health, even be killed. But Job understood that one day he would stand before God. And when Job stood before God, he would be vindicated. And Paul knew the same thing to be true. Paul was looking forward to a day when he would go and stand before the Roman Emperor. Now, in that day and age, if you're looking for somebody who seems to be all-powerful or really very powerful, there's no higher place to go in Paul's day than the Roman Emperor. The Roman Emperor had the power of life and death. He had the power to release Paul. He had the power to put Paul to death. You may remember from movies the image of the Roman Emperor giving the thumbs up or the thumbs down in the Colosseum, right? Thumbs up means the person gets to live. Thumbs down means they're put to death. This is the kind of power that the Roman Emperor had. But Paul understood that he was going to stand before someone one day who made the power of the Roman Emperor look like nothing. Paul was one day going to stand before God, to stand before Jesus Christ, and he was more worried about being vindicated in that day than he was about in the day he stood before the Roman Emperor. So we can imagine, if this was us, how we might feel. Imagine if you're arrested for doing the right thing in some case, which is, again, most of us in our day and age, in our country at least, are not likely to be arrested for preaching the gospel, but let's just say that were to happen, and you're called before some sort of government authority, and you're taken there and chained to plead your case before this government authority. You can imagine that this kind of isn't the day we all dream of for our kids, right? Where they're in prison and they're having to plead their case before this Roman Emperor. But Paul says it's his desire that he will not at all be ashamed in that day. Now, why would Paul be tempted to be ashamed? Well, Paul might have been tempted to be ashamed for a couple of different reasons. He could have been tempted to be ashamed of the gospel. After all, the proclamation of the gospel had gotten him arrested and beaten numerous times. So Paul perhaps would have struggled with the temptation of being ashamed of the gospel, which in Romans 1:16 he tells us not to do. But the fact that he tells us not to do it means that we're tempted by it sometimes, we tell him. Paul might have been tempted to be ashamed because of the position that he was in. But listen, Paul understood that in those moments, you have to have a heavenly perspective. And you have to understand that even if you stand before the most powerful person on earth in this life, that one day you are going to stand before God. If you are tempted to be ashamed of God as you stand before someone that God made, no matter how powerful they appear to be, it's the height of foolishness. Think about it. Cower before someone God made, and fearing them and what they can do to you, and fearing the ridicule and the scorn that might come from the preaching of the gospel message, to the point where we'd be tempted to cower before people God made, when one day we're going to stand before God. This is a temptation that we all deal with from time to time, I'm sure. I think, back to time when I was in high school, for example, and you think about there are times and circumstances like that where sometimes, we're tempted to be ashamed of what we believe, or ashamed of Christ, or ashamed of the truth of the gospel message, or there's times in which we don't want to have to proclaim that truth because we know people don't believe it, we know that they think people who believe that way are dumb, and we know that they'll ridicule people who believe that way. Sometimes, our sinfulness, we're hesitant to boldly proclaim the truth in the midst of opposition because we've lost sight of what's really going on. We're tempted to be ashamed as we stand before people that God made. Forget one day when we stand before the God that made. How silly will we feel? Silly is not even the right word. How foolish will we feel? One day stand before the Creator of the universe and recognize that we were ashamed of God who made us, and we were ashamed of the Christ who died for us, in the face of people that God made. 24. Paul saying that he doesn't want to be put to shame as he prepares to stand before Caesar, who can render life or death. Paul is not being ashamed, but he's actually rejoicing. Why is it that Paul's rejoicing? Well, look at verse 21. Paul says, "For me, living is Christ, and dying is gain." Now, if I live on in the flesh, this means fruitful work for me, and I don't know which one I should choose. I'm pressured by both. I have the desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Think about what Paul says here. This is incredible words from the Apostle Paul. He says basically that he's hard-pressed between the choice of life and death. It's not as though Paul had the ability at this point to choose for himself. I mean, he was going to stand before Caesar, but Paul looks at the circumstances and he knows he can either be released or he can either be put to death. And Paul says, man, that's a tough choice. Which, I don't know which one to choose. If I'm released, then that means Christ. If I'm released, that means I get to go on preaching the gospel message. It means I get to go on strengthening the churches. It means I get to go on missionary journeys, perhaps even going to Spain, which is where he desired to go. So Paul says, if I live, then it's Christ. If I live, then I go on serving Christ. And if I die, Paul's basically making the claim that he's in the ultimate win-win situation here. You let me go, I win. I get to continue serving Christ. You put me to death, I win. Because I find myself in the very presence of Christ. Paul says in Philippians 3, 10 through 11, and we'll get to this sometime, in the somewhat near future, I suppose. But in Philippians 3, 10 through 11, Paul basically says that his goal was to know Christ. That Paul's goal was to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. Being conformed to his death, assuming that he would somehow reach the resurrection from the dead. So Paul's goal in life was to know Jesus Christ, to share in the sufferings of Christ, and ultimately to be raised from the dead in Christ. This is why Paul could not lose in this situation. Even if they took his life away from him, they gave him the thing that he was striving after. They gave him the thing that he was aiming after, which was the very presence of Christ himself. So if Caesar lets Paul live, it's fruitful labor for the church. It's fruitful labor for the Philippians. Paul can go on encouraging the Philippians. He can come and visit them and attempt to strengthen them in their faith. And if he's put to death, then it's Paul's reward. Gets to enter into the very presence of Jesus Christ himself. One of the things that we have to understand historically here is this very Roman emperor that Paul's talking about right now would put Paul to death later. Paul, and we'll see this in a moment, but Paul in this imprisonment is ultimately, we believe from church history, going to be released. He's going to be released from prison and he's going to go on other journeys of preaching and strengthening the churches and all those different sorts of things. And several years later, Paul's going to be arrested and put in prison in Rome again. And this time, that emperor, the Emperor Nero, is going to have Paul back. So Paul knew the reality of the situation that he was facing. Paul's ultimate claim is, look, there's nothing this guy can do to me. I win either way. Because the cause of Christ goes forward if I live and if I die. I receive what my life has been aiming after this whole time. Paul goes so far as to say, listen, in some ways death would be better for me. Death for Christians means relief from the trials of this life. This isn't a morbid claim on Paul's part, though he's searching after death, because the fact of the matter is Paul is searching after Christ. And if you're searching after Christ, then death means gain for you. Because you get what you've been searching for. So Paul says he's hard-pressed. He doesn't know what to pick, but in essence he claims that he thinks it's better for the Philippians if he goes on living. So as we'll see in verse 25, he says that he thinks what's going to happen is he'll be released from prison and go on living because that's what's best for the Philippians. Look with me at verse 25. Paul says, since I am persuaded of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that because of me, your confidence may grow in Christ Jesus when I come to you again. Paul starts verse 25 with being convinced of this, or being persuaded of this. Being convinced of what? I think what he's saying is he's convinced that the best course of action for the Philippians is that Paul go on living, so that he can come and visit them again, so that he can come and strengthen the church again. There are issues that need to be dealt with in the Philippian churches. We'll see very clearly in the coming weeks. Paul's attitude is basically, listen, if I'm put to death by Caesar, I mean, that's really to my gain, but I think it's better for me to go on living so that I can strengthen your faith, so that I can encourage you in your progress of your faith, so that I can help you grow in your faith and learn to trust in God. Paul basically says that when he comes to them again, that their confidence in God would grow. Not their confidence in Paul, but their confidence in God. So Paul believes that ultimately he'll be released and allowed to continue his ministry, and that will be for the good of the Philippian church. So, I want to mention to you this morning two principles by way of application, two truths I believe that we learn from this text of Scripture, two truths about our lives as Christians. And I do want to say, as we get into this, that these two truths are true. Maybe I can say it. These two truths are true of Christians. Okay? So I'm going to be speaking to Christians here this morning. I don't want to assume that everyone here is a believer. Praise God if we all are, but maybe there's somebody here who's not a Christian today, and so I want you to understand, we'll get to this more in a moment, but I want you to understand that what I'm saying right now, these truths apply to those who are believers in Jesus Christ, who are Christians. If you are not a Christian today, these truths don't apply to you unless you trust in Jesus, okay? We'll talk more about that later, but here's the two truths about our lives as Christians. Firstly, our lives should mean fruitful labor for the sake of Christ. And secondly, our deaths will mean receiving the object toward which our lives are aimed, that is, Christ Jesus. We have to understand that as Christians, our lives are to be about fruitful labor for the sake of Christ. We are to be about strengthening and encouraging one another. We are to be about helping each other to grow in our love for God, to grow and to progress in our faith. Every day, every moment that God gives us is an opportunity for us to serve Jesus Christ, to serve His church, to strengthen one another, to grow together in Christ, to progress in our faith, to aim ourselves towards that goal of knowing Jesus Christ and sharing in His sufferings. So God doesn't just save us so that we can go to heaven one day, though praise God, we will one day have that opportunity if we are in Christ Jesus, but God saves us so that we might work for Him right now. Every day that God gives us is not another day for us to spend idly, but it's a day for us to spend pursuing the glory of God and the progress of God. And secondly, our deaths will mean receiving the object toward which our lives are aimed. It leads us to the question, is your life aimed towards Jesus Christ? Because if your life is aimed towards Christ, if your life is aimed towards knowing Christ, when that day comes for all of us, when finally we leave this earth, then our death means simply this, that what we were aiming for, we finally receive. For the sake of the glory of God. When we spend our lives pursuing the glory of God, when death finally comes for us, it will mean we finally get where we've been trying to go home. Some people would have told Paul, look, we tend to think of this in worldly terms, right? Now, most of us, again, probably aren't going to be in a situation where we're put in prison for preaching the gospel message and our life hangs in the balance because we've been in prison for preaching the gospel message. Now, this does happen all over the world, but for us, the odds of that happening are probably somewhat small. But to think about those life and death circumstances that we might find ourselves in when we deal with sickness, for example, we're prone to think of it in such worldly terms. We're prone to think of that if we are healed of our sickness, then we've won. We've been given the victory if we're healed of our sickness. And if we're not healed of our sickness, we tend to think of that as a loss. And Paul would say to us, what is Paul's mentality? If God grants us the healing, then he gives us more days to serve him, and we praise God for it. If God doesn't grant us the healing, if he allows us to die, then we are brought into the very presence of Christ. So we need to understand as Christians, we need to have this kind of mentality that says, we know that nothing can defeat us because of the victory that's been won for us by Christ Jesus. So if these two things are true, I want to think of two applications based on these truths. If what I've said to you is true, well, how do we apply that to our lives? And I would say two things to you about that, two applications, and then a reason for that application. And the first thing that I would say is that we can rejoice in the midst of trials. We can rejoice in the midst of trials. Listen, the Christian life on this earth is no guarantee that we're not going to be persecuted. It's no guarantee that we're not going to be sick. It's no guarantee that we're going to have all the money that we want. None of those things are guaranteed to us. We tend to think only of worldly things like that. The reality is that we can rejoice in the midst of trials because no matter what comes our way, death has been defeated and we have victory in Jesus. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15:14, he says, death has been swallowed up in victory. Later on, Paul kind of mocks death in the next few verses. He says, death, where is your victory? Death, where is your sting? In essence, the claim is that the sting of death has been taken away from those who are in Christ Jesus now. The irony of this is, the tough part of death now is for those of us who go on living. That is tough. Paul says we grieve when we lose people. Those of us who are in Christ Jesus, the last great enemy of death has been done away with through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We can have hope even in the midst of those dark days because we know there's a better day and age to come. And so we can rejoice. The book of Philippians is full of calls to rejoice. Written by a guy in prison who has other Christians who are trying to cause him trouble. It is about to go before the emperor, the most powerful man in the known world, who has the worldly authority to put him to death. Paul says, well, I rejoice. I rejoice because I know that no matter what comes my way, the victory of the body of Christ. So secondly, not only can we rejoice, but we can boldly proclaim the truth in the face of opposition. We don't have to be ashamed. We don't have to be afraid. When you proclaim the truth of God's word, not everybody's going to like it. And some people are going to stand against you. But we can boldly proclaim the truth, even in the face of opposition. Think about it this way. nothing anybody can do to us. There's no person on this earth who is powerful to separate us from the love of God. So why in the world would we cower before people God created who will one day stand face to face with the God? So we can boldly proclaim the truth in the face of opposition because we are confident in our deliverance and salvation by God. If you're a Christian today, you can be confident in your deliverance and salvation by God. Does it mean he's going to spare your life if you get sick? I don't know. Does it mean he's going to spare your life if you're being persecuted for preaching the gospel message? I don't know that one either. But I know we can say the same thing that Job says. Even if he takes my life, I will praise him. And we can say the same thing that Paul said. To live is Christ, but to die is gain. Because when that day comes for us, if we've been pursuing the aim of knowing Christ, that day will be. We've got to be what we were so desperately after in this life. So I have four questions for you this morning as we think about how we respond to this. First question this morning is, will you be saved and delivered by God? I told you a few moments ago, I've been talking to those who are Christians for the most part. So now we get to a very important question, which is, will you be saved and delivered by God? For those who are in Christ Jesus, the answer is yes. This is not an automatic for everyone. The only way to have that salvation, the only way to have that deliverance is through faith in Jesus Christ. Your repentance of sins and faith in Jesus. The gospel message that Paul preaches basically tells us this as we remind ourselves of week after week. That we are sinful people who've turned away from the God who made us. We've done the most foolish of possible things, which we've thought that our own way was better than the way of the God who made everything that exists. So we've been selfish, we've been proud, we've lacked faith in God, and we've gone our own way. Scorn the God who made us. The beauty of the gospel message is this, that while we were still sinners, that Christ Jesus died for us. In our place, Tyler sang about that wonderful truth. I hope you listen to the words as he said. Christ died for us in our place, so that we might be forgiven and have new life. So the way that we have this confidence of salvation is not based on what we've done. It's not based on who we are, but it's based on what Christ has done for us. It's coming humbly before God and saying, God, I'm a sinner. I've rebelled against your commands. I've despised and rejected your authority. I've chosen my way instead of yours. God, I recognize my sins and I turn to you. Turn from my sins and I trust in the Christ who died for me. So I ask you this morning, will you be saved and delivered by God that day you stand before him? We're all going to stand before God. The only way to be saved in that day is through faith in Jesus Christ. It's my open prayer for all of us that we can be confident of our deliverance, confident of our salvation because we've trusted. Second question this morning, is your life aimed toward Christ? Is your life aimed towards Christ? Is your life about the pursuit of the knowledge of Jesus Christ? Do you want to know God more clearly? Do you want to see him more clearly? Is it the goal and aim of your life to know Jesus Christ, to share in his sufferings, to long for the coming resurrection of the dead? And you're raised in. What would other people say about you? What would they say about what you're aimed after? Is it evident based on your life that your aim is Jesus Christ? Are we too focused on worldly victory? we do think about 113 years of God's faithfulness this morning, I ask you a question. What about our church? What do you want most for this church? Think back 113 years. Most of us probably not here 113 years ago. As we think back on God's faithfulness, what is it that we're most concerned about looking forward? Are we most concerned about another 113 years? Or another 13 years? Or another 3 years? Is our driving concern that 13 or 113 years from now that there's still a church meeting in this building? Or is our driving concern we need to be reminded that our aim ought to be God. We're not here for the glory and honor of Grace Memorial Baptist Church. We're not here to pursue what's best in our eyes for Grace Memorial Baptist Church. We are here for the glory of God, for the progress of the gospel message. Do we live in such a way that shows that we are most concerned with preserving the legacy of this church, or do we live in a way that shows we are most concerned with bringing honor and glory to God? The reason that I bring this up this morning is I think that it can be a temptation for us to pursue what we think is best for this church instead of simply pursuing the glory of God. People look for churches today. There's a lot of things that they look for, and some of them are good things to look for, and some of them probably not. Some people look for their own preferences. They look for the things that they want. Some people look for the things that are outlined in God's Word about what a church should be. We have to be very careful in this day and age that we don't get into the mindset of saying that we're seeking simply to make sure this church is here today. That's not our aim. Our aim is to pursue the knowledge of Christ in obedience to the Word of God. And if that means life for us, then we praise God for it. And if it means death for us, then we praise God for that too. Our aim must be Jesus. So my challenge to us as we close this morning is to not worry so much about the next 113 years. To worry about whether or not we're bringing honor and glory to God. And to worry about whether or not we're living in obedience to His commands. Simply trust that if we do that, He'll take care of everything else. So as we have a time of response this morning, there's lots of ways that perhaps we could respond to what we found in God's Word today. So say this week, maybe there's someone who needs to respond in repentance and faith for the very first time. Maybe you would acknowledge this morning that your life is spent aimed after your own good and aimed after your own glory. Maybe you need to repent of that. Repent of that sinfulness in your life and turn to God. Acknowledging your sinfulness and trusting in Christ who died. Maybe some of us who are believers this morning, we need to reorient our focus. Maybe we need to take our eyes off of the things going on in the world around us, and maybe we need to look to God. Maybe we need to stop focusing so much on the darkness that's so prevalent around us, and we need to behold the glory and the radiance and the beauty of God and trust in Him. We have the same kind of attitude that says in Paul, God, I don't know what you've got in store for me today, much less tomorrow, much less today. I want to know you more. I want to love you more deeply. I want to know what it means to share in the sufferings of Jesus Christ, and I long to one day be raised from the dead in Christ Jesus that I might dwell in your presence. If you're pursuing anything other than that this morning, turn away from the things.